In Italy, we have a famous song. Se per caso cadesse il mondo, io mi sposto un po' più. In case the world is falling down, I go back a little bit to not get hurt. But what if a nuclear bomb were to fall on the city where I live in Tuscany, which is Prato? This is something I ask myself with a bit of paranoia. How much further back am I supposed to go to ensure that I don't vaporize instantly? After all, the dogma of this era seems to be never say never. Pandemics, wars, Italy out of the World Cup. Meanwhile, everyone wants to build their own bunker.
Yep, there are companies that are specialized in this. Now you know.
In Switzerland, just to say, since 1963, it is mandatory by law to provide every building with a bomb shelter, while in Italy we don't have any regulatory plan providing for the construction of bunkers. At least, in theory. But hey, what's the deal? We can always use our cellars as bunkers. After getting all the permissions, of course.
You couldn't break into this if you had 1,000 years.
The door's now closing, guys.
However, since a bunker costs several tens of thousands of dollars, and since I'm not paid enough, if an atomic bomb were to fall on my little town, I would have no choice but to run away. Hopefully with a fast car.
Luckily for me, a simulator called Nukemap, created by historian Alex Wallerstein, has been around for several years now, showing the range of action and destruction of an atomic device.
We'll take a look at it, but before I give you an unjustified anxiety, I wanted to ask myself, what are the nations that possess the warheads capable to unleash the atomic holocaust?
These are not so many. On the one hand, you have the classic ones. United States, Russia, France, the United Kingdom, China, which are all signatories of the Treaty on the Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons. But on the other hand, you have four countries that are not yet members of such agreement, namely India, Pakistan, North Korea, and Israel, even if the latter is only unofficially part of it.
Apart from a couple of them, they all seem to be nice and quiet. But surprise! We Italians too have nuclear warheads at our disposal. Oh, right, they are not really ours.
According to the NATO nuclear sharing plan, it has been decided to involve in the nuclear warfare also some non-nuclear countries of the alliance, like us Italians. Mostly for shared strategies and planning, but also for the supply of warheads.
So much non-proliferation. I can smell it.
The US, and who otherwise, have lent Italy, Belgium, Germany, the Netherlands and Turkey their own toys that, of course, they cannot use at their own pleasure. So did you hear me? Don't play with those gifts. The bombs are guarded by US soldiers and without US codes they can't be used.
But in case of war, we still have to prove that we're capable of using them and we cannot afford to fall off the wagon.
According to a report by analyst Hans Christensen from the Natural Resources Defense Council, in 2005 in Italy there were 90 warheads, 50 in the base of Aviano and 40 in the base of Gedi Torre. Today the estimates point a total of 40 warheads, but it seems also that there's a real secret bilateral agreement between our country and the US, called Stone X, which would provide for a further deployment of American nuclear weapons on our territory. Making an estimate of the warheads currently in circulation is a bit complicated, but one thing is certain. Russia and the United States share about 90% of the world's nuclear weapons. According to the Federation of American Scientists, in the first part of 2022, the estimated number of warheads around the world was 12,700. Of these, except those being dismantled, the actual warheads for military use are 9,400. But only 3,700 are the ones currently deployed and operational. 2,000 of these even in state of alert, ready for immediate use. Russia would be in the first place, with 5,977 warheads, followed by the United States, with 5,428, but if we take into account only the deployed warheads, the United States would have a slight advantage, 1,744 against 1,588. Just to realize the difference in level with the rest of the world, in third place we find China, which boasts only 350 warheads, while North Korea only has 20 warheads. Yes, dear Kim, you have to eat more uranium.
We should go easy on good old Kim. Apparently he has some very dangerous new toys now.
In fact, Pyongyang's latest tests have glorified the power of the new Hwasong-17 missiles, capable of reaching American and European soil.
These images from North Korean state media show the country launching its most powerful missile yet. Inside the isolated and secretive country, celebration.
Of course, so far they haven't gone beyond Japan. A coincidence, one might say.
North Korea is provoking the international community, even as it's responding to Russia's invasion of Ukraine. We absolutely cannot tolerate this.
Okie dokie, potentially Kim could hit us right now if he wants. What about the others?
France would have no problem at all to hit their beloved cousins from Italy, and since in the past they have already given us their warheads, I would be careful. Also, USA and UK may have no problem to send us their missiles, and neither Russia. Pakistan and India perhaps wouldn't make it. Both the Pakistani Shaheen and the Indian Agni have a more limited range. After all, they only care about destroying each other, and maybe hitting China. China, for its part, with its D-41 missiles and especially with the new hypersonic models, has all the requirements to be a good candidate to destroy my town in Tuscany.
Come on, bring it on! You and what army? They sound convincing. So what would happen if a nuclear warhead fell right here in this exact spot where I live? Let's say, for example, a Russian warhead hits the ground right here. Purely random example.
First of all, according to the experts of the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists, it's also to be believed that the nuclear warheads today at the disposal of the Russians have a charge of 100 kilotons, which, to be clear, would be equivalent to 800,000 tons of dynamite. Those of Hiroshima and Nagasaki were between 15 and 20 kilotons. Intercepting a nuclear intercontinental ballistic missile is technically possible, but very difficult and unpredictable, given the parabolic trajectory of the ICBM. The most basic system is basically just shooting a missile at the missile, yes. During the Cold War, that's what Russians and Americans called anti-ballistic missile. But we never had the honor to experiment the effectiveness of such tactics so far. Hiroshima and Nagasaki were the only two history cases of nukes dropped on civilians, and Japan didn't have any anti-ballistic missile system at the time. The idea would be to hit the ICBM and make it blow up somewhere other than its intended target. This with all the consequences it may have on the atmosphere. Anti-ballistic systems are present in various countries and are still under full development. Nowadays, India's ABM system is capable of intercepting missiles up to 2,600 kilometers and potentially to 5,000 kilometers. But in a war scenario, no one has activated their own defense system yet. In a report by the American Physical Society panel on the public affairs, even the Americans seems to have a limited capability to intercept an intercontinental ballistic missile. In the study, it is stated, the current capabilities are low, and will likely continue to be low for the next 15 years to protect the US against a strike from North Korea. We are speaking about 20 warheads regarding North Korea. Imagine 6,000 Russian nukes.
Goodbye, sirs!
Proposed by the US administration, the Ground-Based Mid-Course Defense, also known as GMD, is operational in both Alaska and California, and provides more protection against the nuclear threat from North Korean missiles or launches from Russia or China, but it's likely less effective against missiles launched from the Middle East. Here in Italy, we are developing the Aster 30 Block 2 system with a range of 3,000 kilometers. In the meantime, we need to survive without it and look forward to NATO defense sites, one in Romania, the other one in Poland. This means only one thing.
Boom!
Detonated a few hundred meters above Piazza del Duomo, I hope our dear bishop forgives me, the explosion would generate a ball of fire and hot air of millions of degrees Fahrenheit that would instantly vaporize everything within a radius of 880 meters for an area of about 2 square kilometers. The shockwave will then spread fatally within an area of 14 square kilometers from the explosion site, severely damaging and razing most buildings to the ground. In short, anyone who manages to survive within a radius of 2 kilometers and 380 meters, which includes me, will have a short time, because the radiation will prove fatal within a month. At 4 kilometers and 760 meters, the buildings from the explosion will report moderate damage, but the risk of fire will be high though. At a distance of 1 kilometer and 400 meters, for a total area of 409 square kilometers, so well beyond the Prato, up to municipalities such as Sasto Fiorentino, Signa, Campi Bisenzio, Poggio Caiano and Carmignano, but not the much hated city of Pistoia, the hot air will probably cause you third degree burns. But don't despair, you will not even feel them, since it's very likely that your pain receptor nerves will be already fatally damaged. Finally, the explosion will affect a total area of 477 square kilometers around the Cathedral of Prato. And depending on where the wind will blow, there will be a radioactive rain of 181 kilometers, which will affect, at different intensity, a total area of 4000 square kilometers. So, if I wanted to save myself, at least from the damage of the explosion, I would have to move at least 12 kilometers from the center of Prato. I could be safe in Florence, and yes, even in the much hated city of Pistoia. You know, we from Prato have some long-lasting disputes with those in Pistoia. We don't love each other very much.
In case you're luckier than me, you could always live near a large public fallout shelter.
The luckiest ones in Italy live in the province of Verona, in Affi, where there's the largest bunker of its kind in our country, located in the bowels of Mount Moscal. Built in the 60s to house a NATO command post, the bunker is 13,000 square meters wide and can accommodate almost 1,000 people. Once upon a time it was well stocked, but for some years now it has been dismantled and it's now almost unusable.
Il Monte Moscal sembra quasi messo lì per caso.
Era un mistero praticamente, è sempre stato un mistero.
You can also try to be lucky in Trentino, under Mount Mais in Val di Non, where you will find the Gumpen Bunker.
Being bombed during World War II, our country has hundreds if not thousands of shelters, from private to public ones.
In nearby Florence you could look for one of the many city shelters built to escape from the bombings, from the undergrounds of the Basilica of San Lorenzo to Palazzo Vecchio. If you find yourself in Florence during a nuclear attack, observe on the walls the presence of an R, indicating the proximity of a bunker. In Torino, then, under Piazza del Risorgimento, there's still an active shelter capable of accommodating 1,150 people, though during the war it happened to welcome twice as many people. Just as in Naples, where the population found refuge from bombing in the network of 19th century tunnels built by the Bourbons. Famous in Milan are Shelter 87, under an elementary school, and the Breda Bunkers in the Parco del Nord.
In Rome, Mussolini and the Savoia family had their own bunkers
with blackjack and hookers!
Today, you won't exactly find this luxury in the bunker under the park of Villa Ada, once a royal residence wanted by King Vittorio Emanuele III. You will find instead an anonymous and disturbing parking lot. However, Mussolini had two bunkers, one under Palazzo Venezia and another one at Villa Torlonia, both in Rome, but they were not even completed. 45 kilometers from Rome, in the meanders of Mount Soratte in the proximity of the town of Sant'Oreste, you can find a vast tangle of underground tunnels, long 4 kilometers and designed to accommodate the highest charges of the army. These tunnels were then partially converted into a bomb shelter by NATO during the Cold War. Yet, if some ill-intentioned nation wants to attack us, we should expect more than anything else a direct bombing towards military installations such as Aviano and Gedi, with consequences that Nukemap itself refuses to consider.
I sincerely apologize if I too have provided you with a daily dose of atomic anxiety. Just in case, remember your potassium iodide pills for radiation and Nukemap in your hand to calculate the damage and the probability of survival. A small advice, don't simulate the explosion of the Tsar bomb, the most powerful ever built and designed by Russia. You may experience nightmares. See you in the next video. Ciao.